This is Faith in Action, the program that looks at how people put their faith into action in their everyday lives. Faith in Action is a production of Catholic Radio Indy. Now here's today's program.
This is Faith in Action on Catholic Radio. I'm Jim Ganley. Our co-host is Bridget Ayer.
Hello, great to be with you. Thanks for tuning in.
And boy, we've had some guests lately that have brought us into some kind of scary territory. We talked to Father Vince Lampert, the
exorcist.
We talked to the Deacon Mark Kellums about prison ministry, which is a little bit scary. But now we're going to go into the real scary area, the political arena.
Yeah, we're going to be talking about religious liberty, free speech, the Supreme Court pick of Amy Coney Barrett, and the implications her confirmation on the issues for Catholics, and what implications there are if she gets on the court. And today, we're actually really delighted to have Attorney James Bopp, Jr. of the Bopp Law Firm, who specializes in constitutional law and who has litigated various religious liberty cases and free speech cases. So welcome to Faith in Action.
Great to be with you, Bridget, again. Thank you.
Well, and I'm really asking a lot of Jim today because I'm going to give you an intellectual marathon to run. I'm asking you big questions in 26 minutes. So, but I know you're up to the challenge, Jim. All right. So, what is religious liberty? Just give us a quick summary of what religious liberty is in this country.
It's one of the founding principles, and that's the reason it's in the First Amendment. And that is that each of us get to practice, both believe and practice in our own lives, our religious faith without government interference, either by prohibiting us from practicing our religion or by establishing a church that everyone is required to belong to at the pain of torture and death. As, of course, occurred in many countries and still does now over the many centuries.
And is the United States unique in this religious liberty right that we have?
Well, there are now several. We were unique at the beginning because, you know, the Church of England, we separate ourselves from England because everyone in England was required at pain of death to be a member of the Anglican Church, and therefore everyone was prohibited from, if they had a different religion, was prohibited from exercising. And of course, there were many religious wars in both England and in Europe where, you know, the fight was over what church was going to be the established church of that of the country, and you know, we decided that to look at it completely differently, and that is that it would be a freedom of every single person in the United States to practice, to believe, and practice their own religion, and have no state church. And of course, that has served us extremely well, both by providing us a religious liberty that has allowed religion to flourish, to people to practice their own religion. But it has also relieved us of these religious wars that has so plagued so many countries.
Now, Jim, if you would explain the difference, two phrases that sound somewhat similar but have incredibly different meanings, freedom of religion and freedom from religion. And some people try and make those the same.
Yeah, and of course they're not the same at all, because the freedom of religion allows people to not have a religion if they choose. So encompassed within the freedom of religion is the freedom not to practice a religion at all. And now, if they are talking about what the government does, of course, historically, the government has been able to favor religion generally, which is the key, but not establish a particular church that everyone has to belong to. So that was the difference. The Establishment Clause prevents an established church, but it has nothing to do with the government favoring religion generally. So these things get confused when they say things like separation of church and state. They want to redefine all this. Okay, the people that are hostile to religion generally or hostile to particular faiths want to redefine it, use new words, not the words in the Constitution, or redefine the words in the Constitution, and in order to attack religion. And you just asked me about one of these reformulations that does that.
And another reformulation is the words, the freedom of worship. That is not the same thing as the Establishment Clause. Is that correct? Or the free exercise. So talk about that. The freedom, yes. The freedom of worship is not the freedom to exercise your faith.
Right. That's the reason they used the word exercise.
Mm-hmm.
Exercise is sitting on the couch thinking about your religious beliefs or sitting in a pew listening to a preacher. Exercise means you're out and about involved in something. And, of course, the reason they use that word is because they wanted to make it perfectly clear that somebody could exercise their faith in their own life and follow their faith in how they conduct themselves and in the world. And it wasn't just thought or conscience, as another word you could use, a freedom of conscience. Sometimes they say that. That, of course, conscience is just what you think, it's not what you do. And so the people that are hostile to religion want to redefine it to be, oh, well, that's fine if you go to church and you listen to a preacher and you think about, how you believe. But what we're going to prohibit you from doing is doing anything about it in your own life. And we're going to prevent you from going onto the public square and talking about your religion. We're going to prevent you from practicing it in your everyday life. How absurd would it be, even though this has happened in countries, to tell Orthodox Jews that you cannot practice kosher? But this has happened, and because of the hostile, the anti-Semitism and specifically and hostility toward religion generally, is you just can't do anything about it. You can only think it. Well, we go much further.
We're talking with James Bopp, Jr. of the Bopp Law Firm, who is a constitutional expert as it relates to religious liberty and free speech. And I want to talk a little bit about free speech and the protection of that, because it seems like our rights, our First Amendment rights, are really, really under attack. And maybe that's kind of what this election coming up is really all about. And I want to talk a little bit about how the cancel culture is kind of infringing upon people's First Amendment rights as it relates to free speech and religious liberty. Big question.
It is a big question, but let's start with a distinction.
Okay.
All right? The First Amendment applies to what government can do. The First Amendment does not have anything to do with what citizens can do between themselves. It has to do with protecting citizens from the government. And as things that the government would do to limit speech, and of course we have that on college campuses. It's ubiquitous, and of course many of these colleges, and these are the ones I'm going to talk about, are government entities. Indiana University, Purdue, Indiana State—they're government schools, and of course government schools have to obey the First Amendment, just like the state of Indiana does. Or Indianapolis, the city of Indianapolis does. And, of course, it's ubiquitous now. All sorts of speech codes and hate speech codes and, you're offended, so we're going to, by something somebody says, somebody has a Trump sign in their dorm room, we're going to expel them because this is offensive. This is a big problem. And what we're doing is teaching an entire generation or multiple generations that once they get out into the world, and of course they view their college as, now the world away from their home and their parents, that, they can do this in join businesses. Now, of course, the reality is they can. In other words, a private business could say, you can't, you know, come in here with a Trump hat on, and some do, but because they're not the government. But it is encouraging the thought that, and we now see this, you know, all throughout our society, it encourages the thought that really we should be hostile to divergent views or, you know, when's the last time you heard a liberal talk about tolerance, diversity, and inclusion? I mean, that has gone by the wayside. They want to cancel, destroy, run out of society anybody that disagrees with them because they think that they are entitled to prevent anyone from offending them.
I want to, these are all great points that you're making. Jim, I want to ask you about Roe v. Wade, the case that marked the beginning of the practice of the legalization of abortion. Was that the first incidence of legislating from the bench, or did it go a little bit before that in terms of the right to privacy, which was not explicitly stated in the Constitution? I know that's a big question, but is that when the phenomenon of legislating from the bench happened, and maybe what is legislating from the bench?
Yeah, that's really, Roe v. Wade is really the culmination of legislating from the bench as it relates to, with protecting life. And there was several cases that preceded Roe v. Wade that established, in the context of contraception, first among practice between married people and then practice between unmarried people. These were two cases that occurred within the few years prior to Roe v. Wade that said there was a right to privacy that emanates from the penumbra of the Bill of Rights, which is, you know, about as far away as you can get from actually reading the text of the Bill of Rights and find out what is protected or not. Emanations from the penumbra just means we get to say whatever we want about what the Bill of Rights protects or doesn't protect. So that's legislating from the bench, is taking words and either disregarding them or changing their meaning to such a degree that they are that they mean something completely different than what they said. I mean, when the Bill of Rights was adopted soon after our Constitution, that they were trying to do certain things, and the citizens, the people, agreed to that. Okay, agreed to the idea that there were certain rights, and they understood what those rights were when it was adopted. When you have legislating from the bench, you're just saying, well, whatever. We don't care what people thought they were doing as far as rights. We know better. Five judges on the Supreme Court. And we're just going to either put rights in there that the citizens didn't do and didn't want to do in most cases, or we're going to take those words that protect things we don't want to protect, and we're just going to redefine them. And of course, we just talked about religious exercise versus, you know, the right to worship. Okay, as an example.
These are great points. We need to take a break. When we come back, we're going to get more into the Supreme Court and legislating from the bench and what all that means. So stay tuned for more Faith in Action.
You're listening to Catholic Radio Indy, converting the culture to Christ through radio, featuring 100% Catholic programming 24/7. Do your friends a favor. Tell them about Catholic Radio Indy.
Alexa, what's the weather forecast for today?
Alexa, what time is the Colts game today?
Alexa, remind me to pick up the dry cleaning tomorrow.
Has Alexa become a part of your daily routine? Then make sure that routine includes Alexa, play Catholic Radio Indy.
Catholic Radio Indy.
Quick, easy access to Catholic programming 24/7. Just say, Alexa, play Catholic Radio Indy.
Catholic Radio Indy.
Welcome back to Faith in Action. I'm Bridget Ayer. Jim Ganley and I are in the studio, and we're talking with our guest, James Bopp Jr. He is a constitutional expert, and we're talking about religious liberty, free speech, and the Supreme Court pick. I want to get on to these issues of abortion and marriage. Aren't these states' rights to be determined from a legislative perspective by the legislature versus a court deciding? Is that a fair statement? Is that how this legislating from the bench kind of got out of whack? Or what's your thought on that from a legal perspective?
Well, I think that was exactly the design of the Constitution, United States Constitution. If they had intended to, the way the Constitution was framed is limited governmental power with a Bill of Rights that protected certain activities that people wanted to engage in and that were vital for our free society to be able to engage in. And otherwise, it was up to the states, using their police power, to decide how to regulate other activities that were not protected by the Constitution. And it's quite clear that marriage, protecting human life, was intended to be a states' rights issue, something for the states to decide. Now, the only thing that really changed was the 14th Amendment, which, of course, provided a general right to life, not a right to kill life, but a general right to life in the Constitution that the states could not abridge. So to the extent that anything changed, it changed in the direction of protecting life rather than terminating life. And that was the original design, but of course liberals were not satisfied with that, and they proceeded to legislate from the bench and reconfigure our rights and limitations on government.
So would you say it's a fair statement that there is a philosophical difference between Republicans and Democrats when it comes to the judicial branch of government? And if so, from what is that from your perspective? As in, go ahead.
It's huge. The conservatives and Republicans believe that the Constitution protects self-government. That is the right of the people to engage in freedom, except to the extent that they, the people, decide that government should have certain authority. Of course, that's the incorporated in our Constitution. Liberals believe that the government should have all the power, and that to the extent that the Constitution limits government power, they are entitled to treat it as a, quote, living Constitution, end of quote, where they are free to just pour their own political philosophy into the Constitution by reinterpreting it or disregarding its text. So that's where we get legislating from the bench. So if you want every single liberal pipe dream to be incorporated in the Constitution, just put liberal judges on there, and over time they will do this.
So talk a little bit about court packing. What does that mean? Is it good or bad? It seems like Joe Biden and Kamala Harris have not said whether or not they would do that, but there are a lot of people in the Democratic Party that talk about wanting to do that. What would that do from from your perspective as a constitutional person, expert?
Well, we've had 9 justices of the U.S. Supreme Court for like almost 150 years. It is true that Congress can determine how many justices there are. And the only time almost changed, was a change was sought, was when Franklin Delano Roosevelt wanted to add justices on the court for anybody that was over 70. And, of course, he wanted to do that because the Supreme Court had struck down some of his New Deal legislation. And, of course, that was roundly condemned. Democrat senators that were in the Democrats were the overwhelming majority in the Senate, said, no way are they going to go along with this, and it was abandoned. Well, now the Democrats, and let me tell you, they have so many changes in mind to our society if they win the presidency, and they win just a one-vote majority in the Senate and one-vote majority in the House. They are going to eliminate the filibuster. They have probably 100 changes that they have in mind on how to restructure our government and our society that they will pass by one vote in the House and the Senate and sign in the presidency. And one of them is this. That is, they don't like it that we have had a Republican president that has now appointed three justices to the U.S. Supreme Court, which gives a conservative majority to the court. They don't like the fact that their liberal agenda has not been passed through the legislature. So their intention is to add additional justices so that there's a liberal majority and with one vote on the Supreme Court, rewrite the U.S. Constitution. It's a radical idea, but they have a lot of radical ideas that they will pass by a one-vote majority if they, God forbid, get that.
So again, we're talking more about a philosophical difference of changing the Constitution. Republicans like the Constitution the way it is, where the people have the power, versus, in your opinion, the Democratic philosophical is more legislate from the bench and the government has the power. So it's a philosophical difference where the Supreme Court's kind of the focal point at this point with the whole idea of court packing. Do I have that summary fairly accurate? Okay. Okay. So I want to get to this Amy Coney Barrett. If she's confirmed, what changes do you expect will happen, if any? And she's a constitutionalist, correct? And I think that's the big problem with for the Democrats.
Not so much that
she's maybe pro-life or not, but it's more that she's a constitutionalist and she's going to interpret the Constitution as written versus activist, being an activist justice, if that makes sense.
I think that's quite clear that is the case. I mean, they don't like the Constitution as written. They don't like federal statutes as written. And the reason they don't like them is because they have a liberal agenda that they cannot get through the legislature and cannot get through the states, and they want it to be imposed by judges and judges on the Supreme Court. So they don't like Amy Coney Barrett because she is actually going to respect what the people did through legislation and through the Constitution, rather than oppose the liberal agenda on the country by a one-vote majority on the Supreme Court. That's what the fight is about.
So do you anticipate any big changes if she is elected that would impact Catholics?
Well, she certainly respects the First Amendment free exercise of religion as written, that it is to allow you to exercise your religion rather than sit, you know, in a chair and contemplate it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the liberals want to limit it to and allow, you know, for instance, COVID suspensions and mandates that we see all over the country, which in some cases directly target religion and to prohibit people from even worshiping, much less exercising their freedom of religion. So she just will treat it seriously. And, of course, it was intended to be treated seriously. It's in the First Amendment. And the reason it's first is because this was one of the two most important principles that our society was, and our country was founded on. Most important to our freedom of religion, and secondly, the freedom of citizens to self-govern themselves by being able to have freedom themselves and to have limited government that they control rather even controls them.
So would you say this election, I mean, people always say this is the most important election ever, but why in your opinion, from a constitutional perspective, would this be a very important election to participate in?
Well, the Democrats have become so radical. I mean, they in the last, just 4 years from Hillary Clinton to the Democratic Party of today, they have been totally taken over by the radical left, the socialists, the people that no longer, share many of our fundamental values. I mean, you look historically, and yes, we've had Democrat presidents, but there was a common, there was commonality between, among all citizens, Republicans or Democrats, with respect to certain, essential values. The Democrat Party no longer shares these historical common values that that we have. They are very, very serious about seizing power by doing things like packing the court, adding more states so that they'll have a majority of senators and representatives, of ripping away protections for freedom of religion, freedom of speech. They have 343 lawsuits right now to rip away anti-fraud protections that exist in states throughout the nation, so that they will create chaos and the courts will decide the election, not the voters. They are radical, and we are seeing it play out. And they will do this if they get power.
James Bopp Jr. Of the Bopp Law Firm, thank you so much for your thoughts on these important issues. And for people who want to get in touch with you or connect to your law firm or ask you questions, I'm sure you speak as well. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. Give us your website.
BoppLawFirm.com.
All right. Thanks so much for being our guest today.
Thank you very much. Great.
You have been listening to Faith in Action, the program that looks at how people put their faith into action in their everyday lives. Faith in Action is a presentation of Catholic Radio Indy. You can hear this episode of Faith in Action again or any past episode at CatholicRadioIndy.org. If you have a suggestion for a guest or topic for a future program, please call us at 317-870-8400 or email Jim at CatholicRadioIndy.org.